It is 9:15 now, so let's go ahead this morning, get started with prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time that we're going to be able to spend in your word this morning. As we continue looking at enemies of our faith, we see another dangerous one in our greed, in our sinful wanting. Please help us this morning to understand where that comes from, why it is so dangerous to our faith, and how you guide us in your word to forgive us for those times, but also to now in this new life address that enemy. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay. So last week we had the third of five lessons talking about laziness for anyone who missed it. Just saying that laziness sometimes is one of these enemies of faith that's a little bit easier to overlook than the other ones. You know, you hear about doubt, you hear about pride, you're like, oh yeah, those are the big ones. We gotta worry about those big ones, right? And laziness can really just creep up on you sometimes like that. And I think some of our really big points from last week was that laziness, it's really coming from a place where you put, you know, what you want to do first. You know, you don't want to use the talents God has given you. You're not making full use of them. Not saying that there isn't a proper time for rest, because of course that's what God wants for us, and God gives us our proper times for rest. But laziness is, we really got to assess ourselves. What gifts has God given me? What time has He given me? Am I using that to my best to glorify God in everything I do? And I think another big thing we talked about with that too is this isn't one of those things where it's, you know, really easy to tell with other people, because God makes everyone different. Someone can be a workhorse and they can go 24/7 all week long and be fine. Someone, they might hit, you know, 40 hours in the week, and that's a limit for them. God has given us each gifts. Don't look at what others are doing. Look at yourself. Ask, is this, am I doing this to God's glory? And when you do those things, rejoice that God has given you those opportunities. All right, so this week, jumping into number four of five now, wanting. I originally called this one greed, but I kind of thought about that, and greed usually has a connotation of just money with it. And so I kind of wanted to broaden this to more than this doesn't just need to be focused on greed for money, but wanting in general, sinful wanting, you know, money, possessions, a good reputation, and you know, more than what God tells us, fame instead of reputation. So kind of want to look at the whole broad idea of what is sinful wanting today. Come on now. There we go. All right. So it started. Former Vice President Al Gore once wrote, "The accumulation of material goods is at an all-time high, but so is the number of people who feel an emptiness in their lives." So VP Gore served from 1993 to 2001. I forgot to find the exact date where this came from, but either way, even if it was at the end of his term, that would have been 2001, so over 20 years ago at this point. So do you think that sentiment is still true today? Yeah, kind of expected that. Just the, yeah, that's very true. If anything, we see that probably more today with everything that's going on. So if you see this is still true, which we do, how do you see it take shape in your life? Either, you know, things that you might do, things that you see around you going on in the world, how do you see that really take shape? Thanks. Water bottle trends. Yeah, so it seems like every year this seems to be pushing this new cool water bottle. The one that comes to my mind is the Stanley water bottle. If you ever heard about that before, that one's really big. Yeti was a huge one. Yeah, I know a lot of my friends have Yeti still. And well, I think this one's a Yeti gift that I got. Yeah, because it seems like every year the water bottle's reinvented. That's we gotta get the next one, right? What else?
The water itself. Every year there's a new brand that's supposed to be better. So you got more than.
Yeah, there's always something better. That's a huge part of wanting. And the one that I thought, I think I just, the first one I saw was down here, Liquid Death. Have you guys heard about that at all? It's like this new can, and it's designed to be this like crazy eye-catching thing that makes you think it's like, not just water, like it's a cool drink, but it's just a can of water. And so you can look cool while you're drinking it and look like you got a cool drink, but it's just water. And Robin, yeah.
I was gonna say, just the accumulation of so many storage places, people don't even have room in their houses to store all their things. Yeah, our houses are bigger than Navy's time, too. So it's just
accumulating. Yeah. What's the solution to accumulating all this stuff? Well, it can't be getting rid of it. It must be just making more room for it. To keep it at certain spots. You know, you drive down Highway 212 and you go to the stop sign to 81, and between here and there, you're going to see countless houses that just have stuff just sitting out around them in the yard. Whenever I go do visits, I'm always blown away sometimes at some of the houses I see that just stuff on the porch. Like, do we need all that? Like, do we need this stuff? So, yeah, so we definitely know that there's a problem. We see that take shape. What is the root problem, though, that people are trying to address with accumulating so many things? What are they trying to do?
It's kind of like he said there. They're trying to fill in. They feel like something's missing in their life, and they're trying.
Yeah, it's wrong.
Sure.
If I have enough things, I'll feel secure. Maybe try to feel the emptiness of, I don't feel safe. I want to make myself feel safer. Everyone by nature, I'm not going to bring up any specific Bible passages, but you can go find them. People know by nature something's wrong. There's something off. We're missing something. And so sometimes people get to this as the solution. They think that's going to figure it out. And you know, you talk to those people, and so many times it's not the solution they thought it would be. And it leaves them feeling probably emptier than before they even started with it. All right, so let's get into it then. Start with an agree or disagree question, just to get us kind of warmed up here still. Wanting something, so maybe a new car, a new house, going on a vacation, is a sin. See, disagree, so. Would it be a fair statement to say the majority says disagree? Think so, okay. So let's start with disagree then. Why do we disagree with this statement? Ace, go ahead.
There's a lot of scenarios that would make it not a sin if you have, especially if you have one of those things you already have that's been deteriorated, it's time for a new one, or you work hard and slave for it, it's not just a quick lusting after something else, it's something that's important towards the
problem. Yeah. So maybe it's something you plan for, not just I see, I want, I get it now. And maybe it's the really practical things, like the new car, for example. Well, if my car stops driving completely, I'm probably gonna need to get a new car, right? To replace that one. Beth.
No, I agree.
Exactly. You're hitting a really strong point there. God has blessed us with a lot of awesome material blessings. Has he chosen to give different things to different people? Yeah. If he's blessed you with the ability, with the money to be able to get these things, of course God wants you to use those things. He's happy when you get to use them in a God-pleasing way. Of course, this would be kind of, getting off track a little, but of course that ties in with happy hearts, willing to give, cheerful giving. We'll get into some of that a little bit later, but of course, yeah, God's the one that gives us this stuff. So we can do it. We can make plans for it. So I know a lot of us, the majority of us, disagree right off the bat, but if you were to argue from the agree side, what would you say?
I would say if you're wanting that thing more than going to put in the hand, it's going to clean up possession, house, car, whatever, ahead of doing what you know about giving your money to something other than what God wants you to,
Yeah. What's the number one at the end of the day? That should be the big question. If it's not God anymore, if it's that thing, well, it's.
Say what has already have a car or
that one. Yeah, does it become okay? This is something I've been blessed with, and it's an awesome blessing. I look forward to having it. Or does it become, I can't be happy if I don't have it? I can't live without it.
destroying the contentment
that God wants you to have with what you already own. Yeah. All right. Thank you guys for that. All right. How does Galatians 5 verse 17 help distinguish between God-pleasing wants and sinful wants? Can I get a volunteer to read this passage? Steph, go ahead.
The flesh desires what is contrary to the spirit, and the spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want.
All right. How does that help us to see, distinguish these things? Which things are God-pleasing, which things are sinful wants?
Desires of the flesh, or in the godly desires coming from the spirit.
So we this passage is telling us, okay, which is the source here that it's coming from? Is the source, it's very clear, sinful flesh is the source spirit. You know, the new life God has created in me, the Holy Spirit now living in me. Obviously flesh is talking about the sinful nature that's in us now. What do the desires of the sinful flesh lead to?
Death.
Exactly, yeah. It's not going to get us anywhere. In fact, if anything, it's going to get us to a bad spot, to death. What else? It's gonna lead you to unsatisfaction, even more, even greater dissatisfaction than what you had beforehand. Before you start chasing those things, and if we're not careful, our sinful nature can start to run away with these desires. Because the more you fall into them, yes, the more you'll realize, okay, I'm dissatisfied. But that's what leads you to keep going, because you think, well, if I'm not satisfied with this thing yet, it's got to be the next thing. And so we got to be careful. Okay. Is the thing I'm desiring, is this coming from my sinful flesh? Is it going to lead down that path? Or is it coming from the spirit? So we got to keep that in mind as we're talking about this. These two sources that our wants can come from. Oh, I did it again. I always somehow managed to hit the go to end button. Okay. There we go. All right. So greed is blank. According to Colossians 3, verse 5, how would we fill in that blank? Volunteer to read that passage from the screen. Nancy, go ahead.
But to that, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry.
So, don't need to ask, it's right there. No shockers, I don't think, right? Greed is idolatry. Literally said greed, which is idolatry. Explain that statement. I think we kind of said it around about what you heard, but just make it clear. Explain that statement.
Well, we may be focusing on in front on top of God. It's that he's not the one.
Yeah, it's whenever that want takes place of God being number one, it's idolatry. I always like to say this when we get to things like this, talking about, oh, it's idolatry. You know, it's not the little statues anymore that we worship. The devil's smart. He's really gotten us to get away from that, to not really think about that anymore. It's a lot more subtle. Yeah, greed. Anything we want, that's going to be taking God's spot. That's a problem. All right. In Luke 12, verse 15, Jesus warns us that life isn't about blank. So let's get a volunteer to read this passage first. Luke 12, 15, and go ahead.
Let me sit down and watch. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in abundance of possessions.
All right. I'm not going to ask that question either. I think it's very clear. Possessions, right? It's an abundance of possessions. Life is not having a bunch of stuff. Jesus very clearly puts that one out there. I think this is kind of an interesting point so far as we're getting through this lesson. The other three lessons we've gone through, some stuff has been very out there. This one is like one of the most clear, I think, that we've gone through yet. Just very plain and simple. Greed is idolatry. Life is not possessions. And yet this is still one that everybody struggles with this one thing. No matter if you're rich and you want more rich things, if you're poor and you want the wrong things, still at that point, it's universal for everyone, right? All right, but do you think people agree with this statement? So just in general, believers, unbelievers, the world, do you think people would agree with that?
Yes. I don't know, sometimes I think the way we judge ourselves or each other is by those things. Unfortunately, we don't need to, want to, as Christians, but it can be all too easy to look at that stuff and say, oh, those shoes at first, that, you know.
But it's easy for us to say one thing, do something else with that. Yeah, Ace.
With our audience, we do spend a lot of time with those discussions, and the bar helps that start to think your life isn't about faith. Well, it's not. It's a huge part of your life, and it consumes a lot of your time. So it's hard to remember that, keep in the part of your life, it's not your life, that
yeah, these possessions, they're the thing you see, right? All the time. So it's like, well, how, if these are the things I use every day, how is my life not about these things I have? So people might say that. Robin.
But there is a groundswell that I have seen a lot of social media I follow, mm-hmm. minimalism.
Yeah.
You know, and being more at peace and not having so many possessions. And do you really need to have 20 forks when you can get by with 5 and, you know, that kind of thing?
So that's interesting. That's kind of what I was hoping to get at with this. There's a time, you know, and there's some people who will come to the same realization that we're going to come to today without God's word. They'll realize it's not about all these things. So we get ideas like minimalism, which is, you know, just live with the absolute bare minimum. But what's unfortunate about that is that they'll get to that point still, and they'll realize it's not about possessions, but do they still fill that void, fill the emptiness in their lives?
They're still missing God. I mean, that's the whole key right there.
Yeah, they're still missing something. And so what are some ways that they try to fill that if they realize, okay, one is not that? What do they do to try to fill them? You know, you hear people saying, well, it's all just about being as good as I can, living that good life, which is definitely true for us in an aspect, but that's not our primary goal. It's, you know, faith in God and believing in Jesus. So we know that, yes, this is true. Some people in the world may even agree with that, but they still have that emptiness we need to solve. So it's good for us to realize this and also realize with this, even if you know that, that knowledge doesn't just fill this emptiness automatically. All right. Paul tells us in 1 Timothy 6, verse 10, that greed is a blame for all kinds of evil. Volunteer to read this passage. Robin, go ahead.
For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs.
All right. Now, very clear one this morning. It's a root for all kinds of evil. And I think it helps to you know, not just read this, but use a picture to actually see what is Paul talking about here. With a tree, nothing would exist above the ground if it wasn't for the roots in the ground, getting the nutrients that it needs, helping support the tree. So this is saying greed, that's the starting point. That's the sustaining life for all kinds of evil. And how might that be true? How could greed, sinful wanting, how does that lead and sustain other sins?
What feeds the continual habits that are leading to open death?
Yeah, it pushes you further down the path, right? Can you think of any like examples of this? A real tangible thing that maybe you've seen or experienced before with this?
When you see, you know, you're coveting what your friend has, mm-hmm. because it's not what you have, and then you start chasing, okay, well, I need to work more. So you're pulling back from maybe going to Bible study or coming to church or, you know, whatever other things you're pulling away from, filling that space now with things of the world. You know, I've got to accumulate all this money so I can get this stuff instead of chasing God.
Yeah. So you see, there's huge chain reactions that come from this. One story that I actually learned from Pastor on this, that was like, wow, this is a great example of this. You know, if you're going with the word coveting at first, wanting something that you don't have the right to is a form of sinful wanting, right? David and Bathsheba. David sees Bathsheba. He covets her. He wants her as his own, and he had no right to do that. Think of everything that follows after that. Adultery, lying, tricking her husband Uriah to come back home from the war where David really should have been. He tries to get him to sin, and you know, well, not to sin, but to trick him into believing the kid is his own after he gets Bathsheba pregnant. Doesn't work. So then, how does he solve his problem then? Murder. Get Uriah killed. Send him back out. Tell the commander, okay, put Uriah at the front. Take everyone else away from him so that he's alone. He gets murdered. That all started with David wanting Bathsheba as his own. And you see, yeah, okay, it starts down here, but it can grow up into all sorts of things from there. All right, so now we've talked about what exactly greed is. In your groups, go ahead and talk about a definition, a one-sentence definition for what is sinful wanting / greed. So let's do three guys in the front, that group there. Let's do Robin in the back table, and Ace, could you join this group for group discussion? Okay, so take a minute or two, come up with a one-sentence definition for greed. All right, let's bring it back together. Let's bring it all back together here. All right, let's start with the group in the back. What was your definition you guys came up with?
Desiring something above the desire for God.
Okay, so you know we got the two desires touching on the spirit and sinful flesh too. When your desires, your sinful flesh desires, are before your desires before God, that's sinful wanting, yeah. All right, so the other bad group then, what was your definition?
Well, same thing, instead of desiring, you said pursuing anything to build a place where God should be.
All right, so kind of getting at the picture there with wanting, not only is the idea in the mind, in the heart of wanting that thing, but it plays itself out in the action too of actively going to pursue for that thing. Thank you, yeah. Yeah, so good, great definitions there. Yeah, definitely the main points is something above God and putting all your time, all your effort into going for that instead. All right, one thing, it blinds us to the downsides of our desires. So I thought this was a really interesting point. I have a note at the end of this. I read a section from Pastor Mike Nabob's book. See what his name was. What's big, start small, 6 ways to grow great faith. And this was an example he brought up in his book when it comes to wanting these things. It's like a portrait mode picture, you know, where the regular picture, you can see the whole background. It's focused on everything. You can see everything clearly in the picture. But with portrait mode, it focuses on one thing as the front and center focus, and everything else in the background is kind of blurred.
Like my Zoom.
Yeah, she's got that set up, so it's the portrait mode Zoom. There you go. So with that, you see the thing that's supposed to be focused on, but nothing else. With sinful wanting, desiring, you see the thing you want, and you forget about everything else in the background with it. It makes everything else that comes with it blurry. So let's read some passages here that help us just to discuss this. So we will do 2 Corinthians 11, verse 3. Let's do this side. Both groups can talk about that passage. Colossians 2, verse 3 through 4, to the front group. And the back group, you guys have Ecclesiastes 6, verse 2. So open your passage, read it. How to describe how this is true, how we're blinded to these desires, blinded to the downsides of our desires. Go ahead. Yeah, this whole side, 2 Corinthians. Yep.
Sorry, I know that one was a little bit of a stereotype. Yeah.
All right. Sounds like conversation's dying down a little bit. So let's start with 2 Corinthians 11, verse 3. So volunteer from just half the room to read that one first so that everyone has it there. Ava, go ahead.
But I want to read that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning, your mind needs to be somehow pulled astray from your sincere and pure devotion to Christ. So we're leads you astray from your devotion to Christ.
All right, yeah. So who, I guess, is kind of at the who gets us to think like this sometimes? Exactly. That's what he wants you to do. Satan is very crafty and cunning. I love how he brings up Adam and Eve here. What was their desire in the Garden of Eden? Their desire was always God's will. All right, devil steps in, gets them to change their desire, right? To desire instead of God, but to have that knowledge, to be like God, to want something more than what God has given them. And that, of course, he creates it like that for them. He gets them not to think of all the bad things that would happen once they ate the apple. He just wants them to focus on the apple. That's all you got to think about right now. And there was a lot in the background they didn't see with that. All right, Colossians 2, verse 3 and 4. Volunteer to read that one from you guys. All right, Chris, go ahead.
And you are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I tell you this, that no one may deceive you by final sound of the
Yeah, someone kind of jumped in the middle of a sentence right before it says, Christ, in whom are found all the treasure knowledge. So how does that passage help us build on this idea?
Well, you hear phrases like, eat, drink, and be merry, because tomorrow you die. In other words, you might as well enjoy this life, because there's nothing after that. And then you hear phrases like, God helps those who help themselves. The way it is nowadays with social media and everything else, the way that it's put out there makes it sound like you just need to do a lot of stuff for yourself. God isn't going to just help you if you don't go out and do all these things. The problem is you're doing these things without your focus being on Him.
Yeah. So the fine sounding arguments that get us to get that trick us to looking at things like this. You bring up social media. What do people pump out at you to think like, they want you to think, yeah, this is how we should think. New car on, look at me, I just got a new car. Look at this. I just went on a dream vacation. They're focusing like this on just the good thing. Don't think about the bad things that, you know, that came with this, the delayed flights that I didn't get to do, or the time I've been spending at work. I was working so hard to save money for this. They just try to trick you to think like this. Even more than social media, because you can think, all right, social media, it's not a wise thing necessarily. Some people know that. But look at philosophy too. Mm-hmm. Is it, as you might remember this, or someone else, is it the Epicureans that say that their whole focus was just do what makes you feel good? There's been philosophies, don't quote me on that, I might be very wrong there, but I know there's a philosophy that it was, the whole idea was just do what feels good. Just focus on the good things, you know, don't worry about the fallout for it, just do what feels good to you. We get these fine sounding arguments that want us to be like that. All right, last passage, Ecclesiastes 6, verse 2. Go ahead and volunteer to read that one, you guys. All right, Nancy, go ahead.
And God gave some people more possessions and honor so that they let nothing regard desire, but God does not grant them the ability to enjoy them, and strangers enjoy them instead. This is meaningless and grievous evil.
All right, what does that add on to this thought?
You might grant you all of your heart's desires, but you're not going to enjoy it. It's not.
Yeah, so. Exactly. It's not going to fill anything. You don't get to enjoy it. It can feel it. And think about it too, just in life too. There are times when people get everything they want, and then suddenly they're dead. They drop dead. Or they get an accident. They're paralyzed. Can't enjoy all the things that they had. Yeah, Robin.
They're working so hard to get the money to keep maintain what they have, they don't get to enjoy it. The swimming pool in the backyard, whatever, they work so hard for because they're still working. So it's
like, yeah,
their kids or their family.
Yeah. Just because they have it doesn't mean they get to enjoy that. When you want something, you see, oh, it's going to be so good, it's going to be great, and you forget, well, God might have a different plan, or he takes my life. I might focus on it so much, I don't enjoy it. That idea of, yeah, you don't always get to enjoy all these things. All right. But think about some of the ways that making more money / having more things complicates life. We've been kind of hitting this a lot here and there throughout the class so far this morning, right? You get if I have to work more to get it, that's going to take up a lot more time. You know, it's going to hurt my family life. I don't get to spend as much time with them. I don't get to enjoy these things I get. You think about it too. One example that Pastor Navani brought up in his book that I was like, wow, that's really smart. You know, when you drive past an awesome house and you're like, man, I want to live in a house like that. That's the kind of house I want. Well, maybe instead of thinking that first, think like this. How much do they have to do to take care of that house? The yard work, you have to go mow every week and weed everything perfectly. Inside the house, if it's a unique house, you have to do a lot of different weird cleaning things you probably have to do for other houses just to keep it up. Or if you're the person who doesn't want to do those things, well, they at least have to earn the money to pay someone else to do it, which gets them out of the house and working more than enjoying the house. So, yeah, that kind of thought of, you know, more money, more problems. People understand that. Yeah, it does lead to more. Because then also, not only are you having to do more to get it, it's on your mind a whole lot more too. Every single thing you get is something else to be thinking about. How do I take care of this? How do I get this? How do I, you know, so on and so forth. Yeah. All right. We need to be careful too, for one thing, because it leads to destruction. With the idea of the portrait mode thing, this is one of those things that falls into the background that people don't really think about. The devil is a mastermind at getting us to hide potential wreckage, not get us to think about that if we build our life on all of our wants, because nobody anticipates that disaster is going to come. So maybe let's just look at one of these passages here, talk about this. So let's do 1 Timothy 6, verse 9. I'm going to volunteer to read that one. And go ahead.
Those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction.
All right, so you know, it's just, it's plain there. It says this is something that leads you into ruin, into destruction. Because getting rich, it's the roots that we talked about, right? It leads into other temptations. It's a trap. You're not going to willingly walk into a trap. Same thing with wanting, the desire to have all these things. Be careful, because it's a trap that leads you into these really awful things. I looked up, I was just searching online for examples of, okay, how did this come true in real life? And I found a lot of stories on the Enron scandal from the early 2000s and 2001. Obviously, I was like 2 years old then, so I don't remember it, but I read up on it a little bit. So there you go. Sorry if I made everyone feel really old there. But the point is this. They wanted to keep tricking their investors into thinking they were fine. So they changed the books. They covered up all their things. And what were they thinking? Did they think they were going to get on the other side of this, you know, plane, that they could just keep doing this forever? No, it led them into this trap, this huge scandal. It all falls apart. They, you know, just huge problems. Yeah, Rob.
Or you have someone that wants so much that they're using their plastic and their credit card and they run up debt to get everything that they want. And then they don't have the money to pay their other bills. And they lose everything that they have and then file bankruptcy.
Yeah. So it leads you to spend past the blessings God has given to you, to use past that. And then, yeah, then all of a sudden, one day you have to turn around and say, I got thousands of dollars in credit card debt. Yeah, you're falling into a trap and a disaster there. All right, wanting earthly things makes us blank and blank. So let's divide this into the two halves of the room then. This half, Luke 8:14. This half, Mark 4, verse 18 through 19. Go ahead, talk about that passage in your groups. What does it lead to? And just so you know, one passage fills in one blank, the other passage fills in the other blank. So don't try to fill in both. All right, let's bring it back together here. So I'll start with the Luke 8 verse 14 passage. Robin, would you read that one first?
Sure. The seed that fell among the thorns stands for those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are shall find most worries, riches, and pleasures, and they do not mature.
All right. So how would you fill in that first blank with that passage?
Worry.
With worry. It makes us worry when we want those things. It worries us. What's another way? Word in that picture.
Fail to grow.
Yeah. Yeah. So the worries, when it makes you have those worries, it makes you mature in your faith. Because like Dev, I think, brought it up before, if you're chasing these desires, you're going to be giving up something else. If you're giving up being in God's word, you're not going to grow in your faith. All right. Mark 4, verse 18 through 19. I want you to read that from this other side.
Still others might see the sound among the corn and hear the word, but the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the desires of other things, come in,
and choke the word, making it unfree.
All right, so this was actually the same account in two different Gospels. And I think it's interesting that, you know, the angle of it is talking about, you know, relatively the same thing, but they use different words to describe how you get there. So what word is used in this passage specifically? Unfruitful, right? So same thing, if you think about it, if a plant doesn't reach maturity because it's choked out by thorns, of course it's not going to bear fruit. It's not going to have the ability to do so. So when we're chasing these wants, cutting ourselves off from God's word, we don't grow in the faith. Because we don't grow in faith, of course we're not going to bear the fruits of our faith after that. So it's another thing that we need to be really aware of. Okay, this is why wanting is so dangerous. It leads you to destruction. It's a trap that the devil wants you to not see so that he can kill your faith. Oh, talked a lot about why it's dangerous. So how do we address this now? How do we deal with it? Paul lays out a sort of three-step plan in 1 Timothy. So go ahead, open up to 1 Timothy 6. Everyone can open up there. We're just going to break this down into one verse at a time. Talk about each of these steps as Paul lays them out for us here. First passage, 1 Timothy 6, verse 6. Volunteer to read that. Pastor, go ahead.
Godliness and contentment is great.
Short, sweet, to the point. Step number one. Oh, don't want to do those yet. Just leave it. All right, so step number one, being content with what you have, right? Godliness with contentment is great gain, he says. So how does that work together? How does godliness and contentment go together? So I guess let's first of all, what does each word mean? Godliness first. What is that talking about?
Being like God.
Being like God. So trying to do those things that God wants of us, right? Living a life of faith according to God's will. All right, contentment. Happiness. Happy with what you have, with what you got. So we got those two things in this passage laid out. Godliness and contentment. I said, with godliness, there is great contentment. How does that work together? Well, if I want what God wants, what does that tell me about my desires? And what does it tell me about the things I have in my life? It tells me God's taking care of me. God's giving me enough. Okay, so godliness leads to contentment. Great. I'm happy with what I have. And so when you're content, who should you be looking? You're not going to be looking for the wants you want anymore, right? You're going to be saying, all right, I'm happy with what I have, so I'm going to go back to God to say thank you for giving me these things, for making me content. So then you go back to the other side. So you see how they work back and forth with each other. You want what God wants. That leads you to realizing, okay, I'm happy with the blessings God gives. When you realize these are the blessings God has given to you, wow, thank you, God. I want to keep pursuing you more. And it just keeps going around and around like that. It's a really cool thing that God has purposely set it up like that, so that we keep getting driven back to him again and again. So I just had two other passages to kind of help build on this idea. And so Psalm 37 is just very clear again. Take delight in the Lord. He will give you the desires of your heart. When we're looking for God for our contentment, yeah, he's going to make sure that we're happy with that. Philippians 3, verse 7 through 8. So this passage, it's taken from the context of Paul and addressing the idea of following the law to gain your righteousness. So I'm going to read this first and kind of talk about why I'm really bringing it up here. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything lost because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ. So Paul is saying, whatever were gains to me, those things that I thought, you know, living the righteous life to gain righteousness, following the Jewish sacrificial system, that's going to be how I get righteous. Paul is saying all those things, I used to consider them a gain, but now I consider them a loss. And we can apply this to material things too. you know, before faith and just with natural sin, we think, okay, these are what are true gains to me, right? The bigger house, the new car, the fancy meals I get to go out and eat every day. But when we get to Christ and we consider, you know, all that compared to having true faith in Christ, knowing Jesus, my Lord, that really changes the way you're going to look at those things. Because those things that I thought were gains at one point, they're garbage to me now. Because I have Jesus. That's what I need first and foremost. All right, step number two, 1 Timothy 6, verse 7. Volunteer to read that passage for us. So I'll just let you know, too, I just stay open to 1 Timothy 6. I'll be bringing up the other passages on here, so maybe flip around so you don't get lost there. So 1 Timothy 6, verse 7. Steph, go ahead.
Brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out.
All right. What does that one tell us about our things? Can't take it with you, right?
They're fleeting.
They're fleeting. Things are temporary. They don't last forever. Matthew 6, verse 19, talking about the end of time when the last day comes, what we can expect from that. Jesus is reminding them, okay, don't store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. So 1 Timothy 6 says, you can't take it with you. And this passage gets at, okay, well, what happens to it while it's here? It's still temporary. You know, things rust, things break. A really nice looking truck 40 years ago is now sitting in someone's front yard, rusted out, with no tires and no engine in it, because that's what happens on earth. That's because sin destroys everything. All of creation is affected by that now. And people take your things too. If you think you have something and you can be secure with it, someone can take it. It can happen. And Ecclesiastes 5, just really hitting back on what 1 Timothy 6, 7 said, everyone comes naked from their mother's womb, and as everyone comes, so they depart. They take nothing from their toil that they can carry in their hands. You know, I think about some ancient burial practices ancient civilizations had, putting coins on the eyes so that they can, you know, take in the afterlife with them. With Egyptians and mummification, you get in their tombs and there's a whole bunch of stuff in there that, oh, well, we gotta make sure they have it for the afterlife. Not how that works. Even the clothes you're buried in, those aren't going with you. Your physical things, they stay here. You go to heaven or to hell, but everything else stays here. It's just a good reminder. Okay, well, if everything is temporary, I want the thing that's not temporary, which of course is God's word, my Savior Jesus. 1 Timothy 6, 8, last step number three of Paul's three-step plan. Volunteer to read that one. Ace, go ahead.
But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with it.
All right. So I know we kind of touched on the idea of contentment earlier, but I want to talk about that a little more, fill that out. So we know godliness leads to contentment. So I want to pursue godliness. And when I'm pursuing godliness, that's going to remind me, okay, that's what's permanent, my faith. Everything else is temporary. So now Paul brings up that idea back up again. Okay, I want to be content with what I have, if those are the things I remember about. And in Jesus, when he teaches the Lord's Prayer, he tells the disciples, give us today our daily bread. That means be content with enough, with just what I need to live and have a good life like that. And it's interesting in that Lord's Prayer too, there are seven petitions we talk about, seven different requests that are made. This is the only one out of those seven that talks about a physical thing. The other six are all spiritual, reminding us, okay, yeah, I just want what's enough from God. He's taking care of the big problem, the rest, the spiritual of everything. And the writer to the Proverbs too, he has a very interesting point here. I think we talked about this when we did the God Live Life series last year. The writer of Proverbs is saying, you know, just give me enough. Don't give me too little or else I'll disown you. Don't give me too much or else, or don't give me too much or I'll disown you. Don't give me too little or else I will steal and dishonor God. He understands it. Don't give me too much. Don't give me too little. Give me just enough so that I can stay focused on you, God. It's a great thing for us to say too, as we're talking about wanting God, just give me enough so I can stay focused on you. And once again, as we've had with every lesson so far, we always look back to Christ when we're talking about these things. So we have three passages to talk about. Matthew 11, 28, we'll do the front group here. 2 Corinthians 8, 9, we'll do the back group. And since we've had some people leave, we'll just do you guys as one group now. John 10, verse 10. So go ahead and we will talk about that passage. What does Christ's example tell us? So talk about your passage, how it's showing you Christ's example, how Christ fits into this picture here of our wants and desires. All right, let's bring it all back together. Matthew 11:28, we don't need to read the passage, but what was the idea that was presented in that passage for you guys? Yeah, he's the one that's going to give us the real rest, the real comfort we need. Not the next vacation, not the new house. That's not going to make you feel the rest that you really need, that you really want. That comes from Jesus. So yeah, it's good. It's an awesome thing to remember. 2 Corinthians 8:9. What was your passage talking about?
That Jesus became poor. He left all the riches he had in heaven and did what he did here on earth so that we could be rich.
Yeah. Sorry, I forgot my picture for it. Yeah, our rest is in Jesus. It's easy to say. I like, if you can't tell, I like picturing these things. It helps me think about it more. excuse me. Jesus had anything more than we could ever have here on earth. He had it all in heaven because he's God, so he has it all. What did he choose to do, though? He put everything aside for us, every single thing he had, so he could be poor for our sakes and live a worse life than probably a lot of us have ever lived. You know, with all the scorn, the ridicule, the betrayal, the pain he went through, giving up his life. That's what Jesus did for us. What a comfort to know that Jesus didn't, you know, pursue sinful wants. He always had godliness on his mind, had us on his mind to save us. And so because he became poor, we become rich. We get to receive all those things that Jesus had. So I'm already rich. You know, my spiritual bank account is millions of billions of dollars. That's awesome to know that I don't need to want for that anymore. In the last passage, John 10:10, what was the idea that you guys passage was talking about?
We're taken from him, but the Lord gives us everything. We're full.
Yeah, he gives us life, and notice he doesn't just say just life. Life to the full. That means everything that we need. You know, the idea of being satisfied. What does that word talk about? It talks about being filled up. When you eat a meal, and you're satisfied, and you're full. Same thing with the life that Jesus gives us in his word, in faith. That is what fills us up to the full, not anything else we could look for. All right. In God's greatest desire, he's told us, you know, God's desire isn't a new house, a new car, whatever, all that stuff. This is what God wants. This is good and pleases God, our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. So when we think about our desires, we can think, okay, sometimes I know I have the wrong desires. But what was God's desire? God's desire was always for me, to have me as a part of his family, to bring me into the fold of him. So how does that change my desire? Well, it changes everything. You know, I'm gonna want to go after this now, knowing that God, who had everything, chose me. Of course, I'm going to want to go back and show him my love and thanks and choose him and choose that life. All right. So the point, I'm not trying to say in this Bible study you can't take a vacation, that you can't buy, you know, your new house, you can't watch your favorite TV show. Those things are all blessings from God that we can certainly greatly enjoy. But the point here is that maybe a good thing is getting in the way of something better. think we can talk about that. You know, if you take the 5 hours you spend watching SportsCenter or the next football game, and you took even half an hour of that to get into God's Word, take an hour of that to come to a Bible study instead during the week, just think about how much of a better thing you can get, even if you just take a portion of that time out. And so I think it's cool, too, to bring up the idea that God says it's more blessed to give than to receive, too. We think these things are really good, and they are really good, but maybe there's something better. Instead of storing all this good stuff up for myself, you know how it feels when you give someone a gift and they just think it's awesome. They're like, wow, this is great. I can't believe you gave this to me. I know, at least personally, that's a way better feeling than, you know, buying myself a new TV. It just feels great to be able to show God's love in that way. And so to close, I want you to individually, you don't need to talk about this as a group. If you want to share with your group, you are more than welcome. But identify one want in your life. So maybe it doesn't have to be a simple want necessarily either. It can be something that, you know, you just desire. Watching your sports games on TV, saving up for that new car, going on your favorite social media app. Think about how much time you spend chasing after that desire. Then I want you to think about a better thing you could do with even just a fraction of that time. So a Bible study, helping someone with yard, something like that. So my encouragement for you is to take that thing you want and to take just a half an hour from that thing you like to that you pursue in your life and put it towards something better that God tells us about. So go ahead. I want you to think of a real concrete thing in your life right now. Just write that down and challenge yourself to, yeah, this is what I'm going to do this week. This is the half hour I'm going to take to put towards this better thing. So go ahead, do that. All right. So thank you guys for your time in class today. I really appreciate that. Just another thought I had at the bottom too. We think about a lot of the time we spend pursuing these things, but like we said, it's not just the action, but it's also the thought too. And so another challenge point maybe for later this week for you guys, take a second to think about how much time you spend thinking about those wants and desires too, and thinking, you know, realizing I spend that much time on that, you know. Maybe recess. What else could I do with that time I do? And I can't recommend it enough, that book from Pastor Mike Novotny. I included at the very bottom what it's called. Great book. It walks you through the parable of the sower and the seed. He brought up those passages, and it's just really, he writes really well, just very, you know, easy to read and makes you really think about stuff in a cool way. So let's close this morning with prayer then. Heavenly Father, thank you for showing us the problem, the danger with wanting things, with wanting sinful things instead of you. Forgive us for the times that we've done that and help us to realize that it is dangerous, but you've given us such a great blessing to help us change our desires. You've created that new life in us that wants to live for you. And we know that when we do that, we'll find true happiness, true contentment, true treasure with you, our Savior. In your name we pray. Amen.